Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another Paul and Vince's excellent, excellent hobby and painting adventure. How you doing tonight, Paul?
Hobby adventure.
That's right. Excellent hobby time. That's, you know, when you're doing live hangouts, we don't get music, as we always say. So this is what you get, folks. You tune in. You tune in for our incredible singing voices. Come for the painting advice. Stay for the serenading. That's what I say. So, those of you who watched our last show, and as usual, I'll put a link to the last show, which had the setup of the challenge in it, know that much to Paul's great chagrin, we had rolled speed painting, the thing that he had been none too pleased about, at me adding to the list of possibilities. And of course, the week after I added it, it came out the first time, because I have made the proper sacrifices to Zeech. So, there we go. So, Paul, why don't we start just by having you talk about why were you not excited for the speed painting?
So, speed painting sort of, why I paint is sort of a relaxing thing. And so, I feel like speed painting is about accomplishing something in some given amount of time. And that was just never any reason as to why I paint. So, it's just never something I've ever done nor particularly wanted to do. I totally see the value. Don't think that I'm bashing on anyone who speed paints or finishes an army or just, you know, whatever. That's your style of painting. It's just not my style of painting. And I'm also sort of a freelance painter in terms of I really don't plan a model per se as I start painting it. So that really lengthens the amount of time I spend on the model. So speed painting, you know, you kind of just pick your theme, pick your stuff, and kind of go with it really, really quickly. And that's just not my style of painting. I look at a model, I put something on there, and I get it to where I think it looks good, you know, part of the model, and then I sort of move on to another part of the model and do something complementary to it. And it could take a very, very long time, and model might sit on my desk for a couple months before I finish it. So it's just not my forte.
I think that's fair. I mean, I think especially once you establish a certain, you know, I don't know, what we'll say is painting style. You know, there comes to be a rhythm to it, and if you're not accustomed to doing it, it's just as challenging as changing up anything else, right? You've got kind of your own rhythm and your natural progression to how you do something, and when you go to speed painting, if that's not what it is, suddenly you have to change all your tactics, and I think that can be a big adjustment. But it is certainly a valuable skill set, as you said. I mean, there are times when you want to knock something out, but you want it to still look good. And speed painting can help you do that. So
I did learn a lot about looking at a model and sticking to your guns and planning what you're going to do beforehand. And I think that in general is a helpful tool no matter what project you're doing. I mean, you know, I've repainted things that look sort of okay just because I didn't feel like, you know, it was what I wanted, or I changed my mind later. You know what I mean? Instead of sticking to something and just doing it well, right? So I think from the planning aspect and, you know, an execution aspect of it, it's a very valuable tool.
Absolutely agreed. So I think what we should do is we'll look at maybe the results of our speed painting challenge and maybe talk through some of the sort of time savers and what you can do if you're interested in speed painting. It's not like you're probably going to have a time limit like we set for ourselves where we had a hard limit, but some of the things you can do to save yourself time and still have the model look good. So I think we'll try to maybe pass some of the things we tried that succeeded and maybe some of the things we tried that didn't, you know, or whatnot. We can go from there. Sound good to you?
Sure.
All right. Let me lock it up and share it up. All right. Can you see your model?
I can see my model.
So, talk us through, Paul. Well, this was one of your speed painting, and how long was this? This was this an hour?
This was an hour. Okay. So I picked this model. This is just a Hordes model that I was picking up, and so this one I finished in the time limit, and I felt like I was actually okay with the results in terms of what happened for just an hour of painting. What I found myself doing, a lot of it was we were allowed to do synthetic highlighting on the primer. So I did the priming, you know, black and then primed white over the top. And I found myself letting that base coat do a lot of the work. And additionally, I found myself using inks and washes to do a lot of work as well. And what I would do is just kind of piece off things, you know, like the metal there, and then like the cloth is purple and the skin. And I had, you know, different areas to work while something was drying. So if you're really working on a time crunch and you just want to get the most bang for your buck, I would say, you know, either line up a whole unit of models so that by the time you finish the last one, you can go back to the first one and do your next thing. Or if you're working on a single model at a time, that's your deal. I would try and, you know, section off the model in terms of, hey, I can kind of do my washes or like, you know, a layering here, and then just move on to the other side, you know, wipe off my brush, move on to the other thing, and while that's still wet, and sort of complete the model in a quick way.
Can I take a moment to kind of reinforce something you said? Because I think there's a really good lesson there, and I just want to make sure we put a point on it.
Sure.
And so that's the zenithal highlighting. So we've mentioned it before when we talked about priming. We covered this in a previous episode, but just to mention it again. Obviously, what we mean by that is, so when he says you prime the whole model black, right, like all, and yep. then you took white and shot it at it from like a sort of 75 to 90 degree angle, right? Yep. So only from the top yep. was it white. And then there'd kind of be some natural gray that was put at it, sort of the angular places where it wasn't as thick.
Yep.
And you can do that with three colors as well. You could do it with like a black all over and then a gray at a 45 or a 90 degree angle or something like that. And then, at a perpendicular angle and then white straight over top. The key to make that work is you've effectively undercoated your model. You're using your zenithal highlighting primer layer as an undercoating layer, right? And one of the great ways you can then play with that is by making your paint very translucent. So to connect it to another thing we talked about previously, which was thinning your paints. Certain colors will cover over that very well, especially black and white. So a great example of that is purple. If you thin out a dark purple and run it over a black to white undercoat with primer, it will tint the black just a sort of nightshade purple, and it will take the white and make it look very bright purple. So purple is one of those colors that works very well with that. Blue will also do it to a degree, and so, you know.
So that was the other thing I was kind of going for, is definitely choice of color when it comes to painting quickly is important if you want it to look good, right? Yep. Your whole color palette really is no longer available if you just want to do really, really quick things. You know, I'd stay away from your light colors. Whites are pretty hard to do to make look nice with speed painting. Yellows are sort of tough. So a lot of the earth tones are pretty simple to kind of, you know, highlight up. Or your reds and purples and some of your blues that kind of go over the zenithal highlighting pretty well. So kind of think about what color you're sort of proficient at making look okay, and kind of keep that in mind as well for some of the complementary colors you want on there.
Yep. Absolutely agreed. Yes. Stay away from anything that you've got to thin down unbelievably so and apply in lots of layers like white and yellow, because you just, you're not going to have, if you're really trying to be quick, you don't have time to do 10 layers of white or yellow, which is what you're going to need to make white or yellow look white or yellow without building up a bunch of under layers, you know, climbing your way up from a brown to a tan to a this to a that to blah, blah, blah.
Exactly.
Yep. And I think that was great advice about, you know, when you wash, a lot of people think of a wash. I think when people first come to paint, to painting, they think of a wash as just, when I finish the model, I just run some wash over the whole thing, like an Agrax or a Nuln, to get free shading out of it, and I call it a day. I cannot say enough, you should not do that. That is not the way to go. Because what that does is that makes all the colors look the same, and washes make models look dirty when you do that as the last step. So you're effectively making all of your models look very dirty. Whereas if you just targeted your washes to the thing that they should be, you'll use, so to speak, in Citadel shades, use Nuln on the metal, use Reichland on the skin, use Seraphim Sepia on the brown hair, and use some Drakenhof or Druchy Violet on the purple. You know, and as you're working with one and letting it dry, you can move on to a different part of the model. Just that little thing, not making it all one thing, is just one simple step that will make your model a lot better. Even if that isn't then the last thing you do, at least it won't all look the same and be all look all dirty brown or black.
And I think that also paying attention to not only using different washes on different areas is you're probably alluding to, also using the wash as though it's sort of a paint to go in the recesses. You can also use a wash not to just cover the entire area, but sort of actually paint it into the recesses, kind of dab it into the recesses. And that will actually highlight some of the detail instead of muting the whole surface. You know, it'll act as your ink. You can use ink, which is a little bit thicker. But a wash can do the same thing and kind of use its surface tension to get in the crevices. So you can use that also as sort of a lining technique if you direct your wash into the areas you want to go instead of just washing the whole area.
Absolutely. Yes. And it sounds at first like we're saying, oh, that's crazy. If I'm not just able to wash, isn't that going to take a lot longer? No, not really. I mean, think of it. You're still just putting it on the end of your brush and touching it into that area and letting the natural, you know, sort of action of the wash do all the work for you, right? We're not saying like you have to be spending hours delicately applying a wash or anything.
What I'm saying
is be a little more careful with it.
A brush tap to a gap in the armor, you know, a brush tap around one of the notches in the armor where, you know, you can see the little rivet. I'm sorry, that's what I was looking for, a little rivet in it. And that'll just kind of soak up around the area and not cover the whole thing, but it'll make that one single area pop. So that was also what I found myself doing an awful lot was inks and washes into the areas that were very lightly covered over the primer.
Absolutely. Yeah, and keeping that paint thin with that Zenithal undercoat, you'd be amazed how much work you can do. It sounds like when we say stuff like this, often you think, oh, it sounds like so much extra work. No, this is a huge time saver because the first time you do it, the first time you do that Zenithal highlighting with some primer and then just run a very thinned down coat of a dark purple over it, you are going to be like, oh my God, I'm an amazing painter. Just one coat of that purple and you'll be like, look at what I did. I just did like a 4 or 5 color transition purple, but I didn't do any work to get it. I got it for free, right? Of course, you can take it from there, but just even that, it's an amazing time saver, and it will make your model look great. That's what's wonderful about it.
The other thing I found myself trying to do, you can't really tell from the pictures, I didn't take a close-up. I did spend more time on the face a little bit more so than some of the other parts. The reason for this is I personally like to look at a model, especially when I'm going faster than I should, and I leave some areas a little less done than they should be. I look at the model and I go, what is prominent? What is eye-catching? And I spend a little more time there. This model was kind of bland. I didn't really care. And nothing really jumped out at me, so I just did the face to give it some character. But, you know, a good example would be on the PMP. I don't remember who posted it, but they had a looked like sort of a Lord Lewin on a hippogriff conversion. And, you know, it was this hippogriff with these wings just going up really bright, and he had his sword, you know, pointing out forward. And my suggestion there would be, you know, spend a little extra time on the wings and a little extra time on that sword going forward, right? Do some nice, you know, if you're going to do non-metallic metal or something, or just, you know, make sure that the blending on the metal is very nice on that sword. And those are the things that are going to pop out right away, right? And that model's going to look really good if you just spend some extra time on the prominent areas of the model and just let the other stuff be the normal level, right? It's going to make the whole model look better than it is. So that's another thing to keep in mind when you're trying to cut corners and be faster.
Absolutely. That is truly great advice. Yeah. When you step away from the model and come back to it, what's the first thing your eye is drawn to? Make sure that looks pretty good. Because people won't notice the little things unless they get up and really dig and take the time to look on it. When their eyes are on it, find where your eyes fall. Make that part look good. That's great advice. All right. Bases, faces, banners, and shields, right? That's the motto.
Yep, you certainly will be surprised how much better a model can look just with a good base on it. And that has nothing to do with the model.
Is this guy, this is a War Machine Mini, right?
Yeah.
What's up with his arm?
So the Legion of Everblight is they're blighted, so that's the Everblight.
Okay.
I don't know the fluff that well, but technically it's supposed to, for me, it sounds like dragon radiation. basically is the little fluff I know is pretty much what it is. They're infected by blight. So.
Gotcha. So they're sick.
They're sick.
Okay.
But they're happy about it.
All right, fair enough.
And that's certainly one area that I should have spent more time on that I didn't. So looking back in hindsight, the arm sticking out, right, that's a blighted area. I didn't have much time left. I just put some darker area in there and washed over it with some blood stuff. Didn't really think about it. I could have done some different color tone, done something that would make catch the eye. That's what I mean about prominent areas. You know, people, multiple people have already pointed out to me what is on the arm. And I think that that is sort of telling, is like when you lift the bottle, the arm is sticking out. What the hell's on the arm, right? So that's kind of what I mean by prominent things. That's probably somewhere where I should have spent more time than I did.
Very fair. All right. Any other thoughts or tips you ran into while doing this guy you want to share?
No, I think that was about it. I mean, an hour is not a lot of time to experience a whole life-changing thing, but that was about it.
All right. Very good. So here's mine. Now, to be fair, I did not do the base within an hour. The base was added later because, I mean, the mud on the base wouldn't have even dried in an hour. And so this is a Demigryph knight for the Empire. Though people who know Demigryphs will know that that is not, in fact, a legitimate Demigryph knight. Like, the bird is correct, but the knight is not. I believe that is like a Battlemaster's knight. As I got the birds on the cheap, it didn't have any knights, so I just found an old Battlemaster's fig and he fit on there. So kind of talking through some stuff. So obviously, I much the same as you, Paul, I let the zenithal highlighting do a lot of the work here. So this was shot with gray all over and then white at from top down. And then actually what I did, so, you know, one of the things you talked about was having a strategy, right? Yeah. And honestly, I spent a lot of time with this guy beforehand thinking about the strategy of how I wanted to attack this. And in my head, like, well, I wasn't sitting here just staring at the fig. I just kind of thought about it as I was walking around or working or doing my other things in the day, right? And I just kind of looked at the model before I was doing other things and then just kind of tossed around. What I realized is, I wanted to do red because red is easy to blend with very little work, right? Because red is a very translucent color. It just needs to be run over brown. Go ahead. What were you going to say?
I said red's very forgiving. For anyone just looking for a color that's forgiving, go with red.
Absolutely, yes. Red naturally blends easily. So if you're trying to do some good blending and do some color stuff, work with red. That's a very translucent color. It will forgive all your sort of harsh transitions. Now, I realized that because we had agreed to prime only in black, gray, or white, right, that I needed brown for this fig. So I realized the trick here was going to be in turning this whole model brown. And so to do that, my actual first step was to take the sepia ink from Game Ink and not dilute it at all, okay? Which it's very thick. If anybody's ever used the Game Inks from the Game Color line, you know that they're true inks, not like the shades from Citadel, which are fairly thin. And I ran it over the whole model, okay? Exempting the knight. I had him on a little base separate. I just real quick ran it up and down his pole and his flag and his shield and like used the red pieces, but I left him not touched. And then what I did was while all that inking was drying, I then just painted the knight, which since he was mostly metal, was just a matter of, you know, base coating on the silver and then black washed him. And by the time I was done with that, the ink was dry and now I'm ready to go to work on the main bird. And so
you're ready for the bird after you went up and down his pole a couple times.
I went up and down the pole a couple times and then I was ready for the bird. That's right. You got it. I got his pole very well done. I had to work the sort of shaft of the lance pretty well to get the ink on there, but in the end, I was very happy with how it came out. So, so then with the bird, you know, we employed our old friend dry brushing because there is no faster technique. And the bird was the another reason I chose this model was because he had these big feathers, and I knew he would take dry brushing really well.
Hey, man, right? dry brushing is a totally viable technique on furs and things like that.
Yep. Totally. Exactly. You want on this sort of rough, like, feathers, fur, hair, anything that looks and has this very rough textured thing going on, dry brushing is a valid technique. I would tell people, when you dry brush, to take the paint out, put it on something, and then still put in a dab of water or something in the paint. Get it still thin, and then get it on your brush and wipe most of it off. And what that will do, like, wipe a lot of it off. And then instead of trying to get everything on in one dry brush, rely on a lot of fast touches. You know, just go over it 10, 50, 60 times. That sounds like a lot, but you're going over it like this, you know, at a speed. So 50, 60 touches is no big deal. And, you know, it's literally you're going over it twice a second. And that will make it look more smooth. If you leave your paint dry, I know it's called dry brushing, but if you actually let the paint get super dry, you'll get that chalkiness a lot quicker. If the paint is still wet and you're just applying a very little bit at a time, you can get your dry brush to look a lot smoother. So that was the trick there with his feathers and his body and stuff like that. And then I just kind of, on the body, since it's not rough feathers, I just kind of worked with those a little bit. And, you know, just kind of smoothed it back out, took a little of the sepia ink, watered it down, and then just kind of blended that back in a little. From there, it was just a matter of laying on a very dark red color over everything, and then just doing two quick steps up in the red. And that's the transition. Like, you can see, that's a literally, there are two colors of red there with sort of three transitions. So I just picked a bright red and a dark red and then stepped through the middle. And then the gold is just the gold, and hit that gold with a little, our old friend Agrax Earthshade, the liquid talent, and then highlighted that back up. And that was it. Called it a day. And that was an hour and 27 minutes. As you can see, there he is at 4:08 in the morning. No, I don't know where the other picture went. All right, well, I had another picture somewhere that was his timestamp for starting him, but he was an hour and 27 minutes. One of the other things I would say is when you want to speed paint like this, colored primers are your friend. Whether you're doing that with an airbrush or with rattle cans and like the Army Painter line, we talked about that before, they are the speed painter's best friend. If you've got a model that is mostly one color, why are you base coating that color? Prime on with that color. Yeah. And then just start on a wash or even start on a highlight layer if you're not going to wash.
So we said for this challenge, for those who haven't watched the previous week yet, that there was no airbrush involved. Correct. So that definitely changed a lot of strategies for us doing things with this.
Yeah, that's a good point. And we're going to talk about airbrushing here in a little while and as our tip of the week. And I think that there's a lot of things in this that would have been made easier by airbrushing. That's for sure. Okay. Here's the other guy. This was my hour challenge, my little skinky. He was like 35 minutes or something. And honestly, I should have painted more than one skink. That was a bit of a low ball. I should have went harder. But, you know, I look on this all zoomed in and I can see like, oh, I see where I didn't quite get the paint edge right there. And, you know, I can see the mess like underneath here, underneath his little leather strap. But, you know, this is one skink out of 60 on the board. You're not looking at him this close up normally. And I think he looks okay. He came out all right. Here is, again, a great example of that undercoating. I'm letting the undercoat do a lot of work here, right?
And that's kind of, this blue is a nice choice of color, especially for something like Lizardmen, right? Like, this blue is very common. But that, like, icy blue down to, like, the aqua blue, that, you know, dark transition, there's a lot of tools at your disposal for that, right? So when you do the priming just like this, you know, you do your light glaze over the top with your whatever blue you want, and then basically that gives you your highlight from the white to your icy blue, and then you can do your shading with the whatever Azurman blue or whatever the Citadel is called now on the shadows, and that works for a really nice look, right? And then you can even go back up to some brighter blue if you really want to edge out some highlights or something like that, or go 50-50 with white and blue, and that holds pretty well.
Yep, absolutely. And you know, this one little guy took me like 35 minutes, but realistically I could have done a unit of 10 in probably 3 hours, like pretty easily, just because, you know, if I was doing all the same thing, it would have been fast. You know, it's not like you multiply it by 10, and that's what you really want to be able to do. You want to combine the speed painting with your batch painting to have a good looking unit at a tabletop or even above tabletop standard. I mean, I think that's what it really boils down to. Using those tricks, you can get yourself above tabletop standard while still spending not much time.
Absolutely.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, there you go. There's him at 112. There's him at 147. There you go.
Done.
There it is. Since I'm taking the picture with my phone, I couldn't think of what, I needed to go get like my wife's phone and put it in there. So I'd use my computer or something. Oh, there's the starter for the night. There you go. And there, yeah, you can see this is a good example of the zenithal highlighting. You can see it in action. You can see where he's dark gray down here and bright white up top.
I think in practice, I would have definitely preferred, if you're talking about the skink or something, even the demigryphs, speed painting in practice, I think the best idea is to have several of the models that you have your plan, and what you're going to do is just go, you know, this paint here, this paint here, this paint here, and then redo your assembly line down for, yep, you know, an entire unit. I think that's really just the best choice of what to do.
Absolutely agree.
Single models just really doesn't work that well. It doesn't work up to its full potential.
Right. I agree. I mean, it was a good challenge. I'm certainly glad we did it. And I think it was fun. It's fun to challenge yourself. It's actually fun to work under the clock a little bit, because I wouldn't want to do it all the time. As you said, this is a hobby. It's for fun. But it did bring a new element to it, right? Like, of, you know, having to sit there, and as you're painting, you're like looking at the clock. I'm like, okay, gotta keep going.
It was actually making progress, right? I've had pieces on my desk that I feel like I've sat there for a week and not made any damn progress on. And I think that, you know, even if you extend out the clock to a normal painting center, so I'm like, you know, I'm only putting 10 hours into this fig and it needs to be done. If you dock it and, you know, you start making real progress, or, you know, planning things out again in a quicker sense, I think that that's a valuable tool. Cause I mean, you do want to make progress. Even me with painting for mostly fun purposes, not really on a time constraint, just to do it as relaxing time. You still want to finish, like, you know, that good feeling comes from finishing a fig. It doesn't come from having 10 unpainted sheets on your desk, right?
Right.
So.
Yep. So, I would say, so here's Vince's tips for speed painting that I would sum up like this. One, have your strategy, right? Like, know what you want to do and know what that model looks like before you start it, if you're going to speed paint. If you're just free painting and you know, then whatever, do as you will. But if you're going to try to speed paint, have your strategy. Look at the model. Figure out what colors are going to go where and know that in advance. Two, make sure your priming strategy matches that paint strategy. So if you're going to use mostly reds and golds, then prime the model in brown, like a leather brown. Or undercoat it in brown and then use like a lighter tan, like a desert sand primer on the top to do zenithal highlighting in brown tones. Okay, whatever. You know, these rattle cans, you can get a bunch of them. They last a long time. Three, once, if you're doing that zenithal highlighting, especially with black to white, then stick to your blues, your purples, even green will work to some degree, red. And thin that down and just run a coat over that and see what you think of it. You can get a lot of work out of that. Four, dry brushing is your friend as long as it's the right texture you're working with. Five, your paints, if you're speed painting, understand what colors you're restricted to. Stay away from super brights, whites, yellows, things of that nature. Stick to easy to blend colors, reds, black, you know, various browns. All sorts of browns will work very easily. Did I miss anything?
No, I think you hit most of it. Again, I have to kind of tip my hat. I've never really been one for this, but I feel like I learned a lot, and you can use some of the tips and tricks to make things that you do for a full paint job, you know, things that you do halfway, you kind of use on that concept as well. Again, this is sort of tying back into you never really use one technique or the other. You use everything you assemble and sort of use that in your repertoire on every model.
Yeah, absolutely agreed. Yeah, getting good at these sort, just like we talked about with non-metallic metals, right? And I thought you summarized it very well, that like by learning that technique, you're actually learning five or six other ones that will help you in everything else you do. And I feel like this is another example of that. If you get good at speed painting, then you can get good at understanding. Once you're understanding how to shortcut the things, you know how to, you can also learn the same techniques that will help you when you're doing a longer, more detailed job.
Absolutely.
All right. Very good.
Shortcuts.
So, speaking of shortcuts, was that a segue?
Segue!
Oh, by the way, Skeleton Flower says that that dragon radiation is the perfect way to describe all the weirdness going on with the blightedness. So there you go. He confirmed your statement there of dragon radiation. Skeleton Flower said that. So, speaking of shortcuts, yes, I like it. Perfect segue. So what is our quick tips of the week going to be about this week, Paul?
I think we're talking about airbrushing this week, right?
That's right. Yes, right, talking about airbrushing.
First, I would like to debunk the myth that airbrushing is a shortcut for some things, but don't think it's going to magically make you an amazing painter.
That is absolutely true. Yes. It is not, unless you're painting all tanks or like Eldar wave serpents or something, in which case, man, it will take those to the next level. Because there is some pretty amazing stuff you can do with an airbrush on big vehicles that you can replicate. What's that?
On a giant flat surface, yes.
Yes, exactly. On a giant flat surface. There's amazing things you can do on vehicles that you can replicate with a brush if you want to spend about 10 times as much time doing it. But an airbrush will take large flat surfaces and make the amount of time you have to spend on them go whoop and just disappear. So let's talk about airbrushing in general. Paul, I think you've been airbrushing longer than me. So why don't you talk about how you use your airbrush? What do you do with it? Like what's your preferred method for attack, and what do you use it for, and what do you not use it for?
All right, so when I first started, which I think is I was always interested in airbrushing. And when I first started, I started with a poor quality airbrush, a plastic junker. And I used this for basically priming color. You can get those spray paint cans that have different colors, but it doesn't quite do the same as being able to thin down whatever color you want from your range and spraying a model that color to start with. Like for Vince's speed painting case, he could pick his brown and then, go up the color he wanted to use and do the angled highlighting basically with the airbrush to start with. And that made a lot of sense to me. At the time I had an Orcs and Goblins army, and who the hell wants to paint that much green? Right, so you could do a lot of base priming with an airbrush. So that is the first use that I think is really useful for beginner airbrushes and in general hobbyists, someone who doesn't really want to get great with the airbrush, to use that for just base coating, your army with your favorite color of sorts. It's going to be the main color on your army. Again, Beastman Brown comes to mind, or, even metals. I mean, Vallejo makes very nice airbrush metallics, and you can do, your Chaos Warriors or some crap like that, or your Black Orcs, in metallics, and that's really nice and easy to do, and it comes out nice and smooth. So that's really where I would start with. Past that point, you can do really, really nice effects. Some of the things that it works really, really well for coming to mind are object source lighting. You can get some nice glow effects going. Depending on how good you are, you can get kind of glowing eyes and things like that. A lot of symbols or really, really soft things. If you just want to layer a color over the top of something that's really watered down, and just, you know, you have something you painted and you want it to kind of tint a different color, it's really good for that on surfaces like that. Non-metallic metals on flat surfaces. Again, we come back to this flat surface. You can use it. You know, it's really, really good for swords, other things like that. What it's not so great for, and it's not going to help you with, is standard infantry. Beside base coating and maybe weapons, you cannot pick out and use an airbrush on basic infantry for, you know, painting different parts. You can mask things, which we'll talk about in a little while. I don't want to get too in-depth or off-topic with that yet, but don't expect it to really do wonders for your tiny models. You're still going to have to use a brush to complete a model. But your big figs, you know, your Carnosaurs, your Basilodons, your War Sphinx, all that, it's really helpful to get those big areas going. Past that, I think it's a phenomenal investment. I really enjoy using it. I have a fun time whenever I use it, you know, finding different applications for it. I never come up here and fiddle with the airbrush and kind of feel like I wasted my time or got upset. You know, sometimes you get frustrated with a brush. I feel like I almost never get frustrated with the airbrush. It's just kind of fun to do and fun to play around with. It's just something different, you know, kind of like a man toy sort of deal. So those are just kind of my thoughts on beginning with the airbrush and what you can do with it.
Yeah, I would echo all of those thoughts. Absolutely. It is, once you prime with an airbrush, you'll never want to really prime with a rattle can again, because it gives you just the thinnest, most even, non-detail destroying prime ever, and you can do it in so many different colors, and you can undercoat so easily, all that kind of stuff. Also, when you're doing big models, it just, I mean, it is such an unbelievable time saver when you can do the whole body of a big model in minutes as opposed to needing to brush paint that. So, you know, just an easy example. So here's a guy that I'm currently working on the base for. He's almost done. This War Sphinx here. So, I mean, like, normally it would take a long time to paint him black and do a little bit of highlighting to get the gray on there and such, or to do the little red for the lava stripes. But, you know, it was maybe 30 minutes, 40 minutes to get all of them done.
The grand scheme of things, it's not going to matter to a lot of people, but it actually does save you a ton of paint.
Yep.
Not having to drop it out and brush it out saves you a lot of paint when you prime with an airbrush instead of brushing over large surfaces. So.
Also a great point. When it comes to a lot of like techniques with them, the other thing I would say is points of light. Airbrushes do points of light really well if you're working on armored surfaces or stuff like that. So this is like especially relevant in 40K more than fantasy, but you can still do it in fantasy too. But where you're trying to create metals in other colors, like Space Marines, where you want points of light, you can do that really easily with an airbrush and thinning down your airbrush paint. This right here is my little Bible. This is, I don't know if that's backwards or not for everybody. It probably is. But that's Angel Giraldez. He's the house painter for Corvallis Belli. I don't know how you say that. Corvus Belli, whatever. The Infinity Range. He's their house painter. And he uses an airbrush like exhaustively. And this book just walks you through his techniques and how he does stuff. I cannot recommend this book enough. If you can get a copy of it, it is amazing. And we'll give you this right here. We'll give you detailed explanations of techniques that we couldn't cover if we had took the next 3 hours to do.
So. And if you want another place, free resource online, buypainted.com is not a, not buypainted on YouTube. I'm sorry, not .com. Buypainted is not only a miniature like painting service, but he puts out a ton of YouTube content about how to use an airbrush. And he's pretty good. The other one is Awaken the Realms. They put out the occasional stuff on what they airbrushed and some painting videos. So those are two resources on YouTube, and there's tons of other resources out there. Obviously, those are miniature specific, but you can use similar techniques on bigger scale things and just kind of scale it down. I mean, I've done realistic flames that were done, you know, for large scale and sort of trying to scale it down. But there's tons of resources and things you can do. And again, when you were talking about 40K, that Space Marine shoulder pad idea, it really comes back to that. you know, flat, bent, curved surface. Like, airbrushes are really, really great for any sort of flat, curved surface for points of light and highlighting. So that's really, really good point.
Yep. And I would say when you're, so for those people who might be thinking about sort of the investment of an airbrush and do you want to get into it? You know, you're probably thinking to yourself, it's a lot of money. I don't know if I want to do it. I don't know how much I'm going to use it. And I will say that to get going is not a huge investment, but it's not a small investment either. But I think it's a very worthwhile investment.
So I will say, I'm not trying to pick on anyone. I really am not. But in our hobby, for the vast majority of people who are doing it, they have the expendable income. It's in that price range where if you're doing this hobby, you probably have the expendable income to get an airbrush. Right? I mean, that's on the scale we're talking about. We're talking about, you know, good airbrushes, couple hundred bucks with a good compressor. I mean, you could buy a really, really nice compressor and airbrush setup for probably under $500. And beginner stuff, way, way cheaper than that. I'm saying, like, you know, a very good airbrush and a very good compressor for under $500. We're not talking about thousands of dollars.
Yeah. And I'm going to put a link. I'm going to put a bunch of links, actually, into the description of this. So look down here. I'm going to put a bunch of links in the description of this that have what I would consider all of the possibilities for your starting setup kit. And I think if you bought every single thing that I link you, it's probably under $300, probably well under, including a compressor and airbrush, because what I'm going to link you is truly like the starter model for both. It's a compressor that works and is perfectly functional, and an airbrush that works. It's like a Master Series airbrush. They're not amazing, but you know what it will do? It will airbrush paint, and it will do so pretty well. And if you take good care of it, it will last actually quite a while. Long enough for you to learn it, learn what you like and don't like, and to know then where you want to spend your money when you want to step up and make a more serious investment.
If I don't say this now, I'm going to forget it while we're rambling.
Go ahead.
One tip I will give you if you invest in an airbrush, absolutely 110%, do not ignore this. Learn how to clean it. You have to clean the living crap out of it, not in a painful way. Just learn, get your routine down for cleaning out the paint almost immediately after you use it. Do it properly, the airbrush will treat you amazing. Do it improperly, you're going to have more issues than it's worth. So look up how to take care of your airbrush before you start using the damn thing. Don't make that mistake of leaving paint in it or things like that. It's a very quick way to ruin an amazing tool.
Absolutely agreed. Yes, it is. That is no joke. It is 100% the type of thing where it doesn't take a long time to clean it out. It's just a few moments, realistically, after, you know, 5 minutes after you use it. If you don't do it, you'll pay the price. And you'll spend a lot longer than that trying to get gunked paint out of deep inside the thing. So I'll throw some links for all the starter stuff that would get you going. I think it's a worthwhile investment. If you're a serious hobbyist, think about it this way. I'm willing to bet you spent more than $300 on any one army you own, right? And how much time do you actually spend playing on the table with that army? I'm going to guess if you're lucky, you spend about 4 hours a week playing with that army. Okay, on average. How much time do you spend painting? Probably more than that. And this is less than the investment of one army, and you're going to use it on every army and every fig you paint, more or less, from here until the end of time. Right? So when put in those terms, I think it's a worthwhile investment. Okay, so other things I would say with an airbrush is a lot of the same techniques we've been talking about you can use with an airbrush. So we've talked before about glazing, right? About thinning paints way down and applying lots of thin layers. The trick is when you're airbrushing, you need to be thinking about the same thing, about how thin you're getting your paint. Because the same rules of like base and layer and glazing apply with an airbrush. So you can, one of my favorite light nice tricks is to, you want to make a real stark transition between black to yellow. I don't know, something crazy. Take that black, put in some gray, like a light gray, and then run white down over that. So you got this black, gray, white transition. Then thin yellow way down. Like, so you got a real thin glaze yellow. Even thin by airbrush standards. And when you sort of spray that over the whole area, it will completely turn the white yellow. It will tint the gray, and it will not even show on the black, right? Because it's so thin and you're applying so little paint. So those same kind of tricks and techniques when painting, you can also do with an airbrush.
In while we're talking about this real quick, mixing, I'm going to show you a little tip trick that if you have an airbrush, you probably already know, but he's going to show you this. If you're talking about glazing or anything like that or mixing paints, obviously we have a top fed, which is probably one of the airbrushes you're going to recommend. It has a nozzle guard where your needle is, so you're going to be spraying this way out. What you can do is you put paint, you know, a droplet, and then you put glaze media in there, and you can actually put your finger over the top here and put some air through, and it's going to back channel that air and actually just mix everything in that pot. So you can actually mix everything within the airbrush pretty simply, and it's very easy to transition, even going up layers, right? You can go, you know, I want to start with this dark purple and then go to this light purple, and you just keep adding the lighter purple to your pot and keep mixing it, and you can just keep just adding a lighter and lighter color. So you can do some very nice mixing within the pot as well.
Yep. That's great. That's great advice. Yeah. The finger cover thing, is really good. The first time you discover that you can do that, it makes your life so much easier than trying to like put a brush down in there to mix or anything crazy like that, which you don't really want to be sticking much of anything down in there because you're going to hit the needle. Like the needle's in there. And yeah, if you bend that needle, you're done. Like you got to buy a new needle. That's it. Needles are more or less unrepairable once they're bent. So be very careful with that needle. It is the part of the airbrush that's the most sensitive.
But I will make a point that most needles run $10, so it's not like they're crazy expensive to repair. So, or to get replaced, sorry.
Right. Okay, so what would you say for you, let's say like you had your airbrush, if you want to kind of talk about it real quick. Let's just cover some very simple basics of the airbrush use and sort of the link I have will have all these sort of all the good basics that I would recommend in an airbrush. But let's just talk about basic functionality of the thing, because some of that might even be a bit mystifying.
So like what type of airbrush we're recommending?
Yeah, gravity fed versus.
I'm assuming that you're recommending a dual action.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So why don't we explain that?
So this is what an airbrush looks like. This is a Iwata Eclipse HC. So this is actually probably, you know, an upper tier, not top tier by any means, but a middle of the road, pretty good airbrush. Something I would absolutely recommend. It will do pretty much every bit of your modeling needs for not a crazy amount of money. What you have here is a gravity feed. So this is where you put the paint in. This is attached to the body, and then the paint will come out the front here. This is the bottom hose where you will connect your compressor. And then this is your trigger. And why this is dual action is you actually press down the trigger, and that starts the air. When you keep pressing down as you pull back, paint will be released from the hopper and go into the airstream and out the front of the brush. So down, back, dual action. That's the type of airbrush that you really want. It gives you a ton of control and allows you for a pretty good experience, I think. So that's sort of the standard, you know, point and shoot idea of an airbrush.
Yep. I would absolutely recommend gravity fed for miniature painting, and I would and dual action is an absolute must. And the thing I'll put down there will have both of those things. The people who use the bottle airbrushes, which is just the same thing, but imagine it flipped over, right? Where the thing that holds the paint is underneath, and it sucks the paint up because it's vacuum based. That's good for people who do big installations with their airbrush, you know, their car painting, and they need to be able to like unscrew it and swap on a new paint. That's really the big advantage of that, is that I can unscrew the whole thing, take it off, set it down, seal it, get a new one, screw it in, and go.
If you're painting motorcycle tanks, I'm sure that you would want that. But right, realistically, we don't want more than a couple drops of paint in our hopper at a time, unless you're priming an entire 2,000-point army, then maybe you want to fill more. But usually, you're not going to need more than several drops. I mean, this is a giant cup on this. Like, I've never had anything even remotely close to filling that halfway.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I think that's all very good. I would say Anytime you're working with your airbrush, you're putting paints in there. The last thing I would reference with this when we're talking about airbrushing is you need to really think about your paints and what you're putting through that airbrush. And by that, I mean, so if you're going to try to run this, which is just Vallejo model color, one of the thicker paints, honestly, around, through an airbrush, you have to thin this a lot. Like, this will go, but you have to get, you know, the airbrush medium. I'll have a link for that down there too, the brand I like, but there's plenty out there. I'm not honestly super brand loyal, so whatever, but you got to thin it out with a medium, not just with water. That's not what you want. You want to thin it out with an airbrush medium.
I don't mean to self promote, but if you put a link down there, Vince, I have a make it yourself airbrush thinner that works great.
Awesome.
So, yes. And that's dirt cheap as well.
Very good. I love it. Yeah. And that's another thing. Like, we keep referencing YouTube. There's lots of good videos out there for making what to use for cheap airbrush cleaner that's still effective, what to use for thinner. These things all exist. Go out there, hunt them up. I'll try to grab a couple and throw them in there. There's going to be like 8 million links at the bottom of this, but I'll try to keep it all straight. So with this, you need to thin it way, way, way down, right? Be aware of the paint you're using. Now, compare that to, say, this, Moon Yellow in the Game Air range, right? Which is probably the thinnest paint in the Game Air range, which is already thinned for airbrushing. This, unless you're trying to just do a glaze, you could probably shoot the yellow straight through without thinning it at all. If you get into some of the other colors, I would see, even with Game Air, I still thin it out most of the time.
So Vince, you say don't put the thick stuff through. What happens when you do put that straight into your airbrush?
Yeah, that's a great question. You stop getting paint real fast, because what's happening is air is being forced at a very high velocity over your paint, right? And so what's happening is if the paint is already thick, it's going to dry the paint immediately. And it's forcing the paint through this tiny, tiny little hole. That's what it's doing. That's when you're pulling the needle back. I was about to make a sexual sort of image. But when you're pulling the needle back, it's allowing just the littlest bit of paint to escape in there. And what's going to happen is it's going to gunk up that tube immediately, and at best, it just stops flowing, and you've got to dump all the paint and scrub your airbrush down. The more likely scenario and the far worst outcome is you get the splatter effect, right? Where when you push down the trigger and pull, it just goes nothing, nothing, nothing. And it looks like, yeah. It looks like you're on Nickelodeon's You Can't Do That on Television, and you just said, I don't know, and got slimed, right? As it just sort of pops like a water balloon all over your miniature.
So, Vince is absolutely have nothing to disagree with that. That's what's going to happen. We're just trying to save you the hassle. You can absolutely try and put thick paint in. It may work for a couple sprays, to be honest, and then you're going to get what's called dry tip, which is exactly what he just explained. It's going to gunk up your airbrush. It's not going to be a pleasant experience. So we're really just trying to help you out. You really do need to thin it down. And actually, the needles are you know, 0.0 millimeters, right? They're 0.3 millimeters, 0.5 millimeters. They're very small. So actually, the airbrush range, usually airbrush paints, are not only thinner, but the pigment is actually ground finer. Like, the stuff that makes the color is actually ground down to a smaller grit, so that it doesn't clog the airbrush either. That's the size that we're talking about. So there is actual value to airbrush paints other than simply they're pretty thin as well.
Yeah, I will say, like, the Game Air range, which I just showed one over, whatever. I've said it before on the show. I'll say it again. It's the best range of paint I've ever used. I love it. I use it for just about everything as my main line. It's so much easier to thin and work with. Can't recommend it enough, so. Yeah,
I've also gotten into, this is Golden High Flow, that works very well, and it's really nice to grab the basic colors, right? You can get your blacks, your whites. It gets a little bit bigger volume, maybe a little bit cheaper than Game Air per ounce or whatever. So that works perfectly well for some of your other colors, but they obviously don't have the color selection that a model company is going to have. But for your blacks and whites, perfectly fine.
Yeah, and speaking of, so we talked about why the paint is drying out. So something like this is a great friend of yours. There's a bunch of these out here. This is just one I happen to have. This is a retarder medium. It retards the paint from drying. This is a good friend of yours. If you're using an airbrush, you can do note that this will have exactly the effect it says. It will keep the paint wet longer, meaning even after you shoot it on the model, so don't be touching it in places where you sprayed. It will stay wet. There's lots of different paint retarders out there, retarder mediums, and all of them are a very useful tool when working with your airbrush.
So I'll tell you one trick that I usually do for drying retarder thinning media. So whenever I go to put a paint or change a paint into my airbrush, this is my bottle of thinner, which has drying retarder and flow aid in it. I actually put a drop or two into the hopper and actually spray most of it out almost entirely, especially if I don't want to thin the paint. And what this does is it just actually coats the innards of the airbrush with drying retarder and with thinning media. It really helps the flow through. Even though you're not really thinning the paint itself, it just adds a little extra, you know, it's kind of like greasing the pan, right? You know what I mean? It kind of just adds a little bit of lubricant in there to start with.
Absolutely. Love it. Yeah, that's a great tip. Hot tip. Kiss live horse archers. All right.
We could be talking about this for the entirety of the night. Did you want to show your little kit real quick?
Yeah, sure. Let's do that. Let me just grab that and go through that real quick. Let me actually grab the link.
I have some suggestions for at least for an airbrush that I would recommend starting with. If you want to invest a little bit more money, I don't know what you picked out. So
this is
ladies and gentlemen.
Not a problem. I let me share up here real quick. I picked what I think is your simple starting model to learn on. This is your training wheels. Let me screen share here. Okay, so can you see that okay?
Yep, there we go.
All right, so this is the little Master Series combo. Nice little compressor and airbrush and your little how-to guide. You get the tube with it here, you know, whatever, and it's $80.
That looks like a pretty good deal.
And this is, you know, what I got to start with, and it's great. I mean, for when you're learning, your first car, you don't go buy a Mercedes-Benz, right? Like, I mean, because you're going to mess that car up. You start with something functional that will get you from A to B. A is an unpainted model. B is a primed or painted or base coated model with an airbrush. And this will get you there. Are you going to be able to draw fine lines? No. But that's okay. You don't need to draw fine lines right when you start, right? You just need to learn how to control it, how to get the feel for it, how to work with the tool, and that's what this will do.
Yeah, looks good. I mean, that is a cheap combo kit right there. You're not going to do much better than that. I can't speak to how that compressor works. A compressor is an important part of the kit. I mean, that's an important part of your setup. That's what powers your airbrush, gives it life. If the airflow is not constant through the compressor, you will have difficulty doing fine detail work. Priming will be totally fine. You're not even going to notice. When you start getting a better airbrush, you will likely also need a better compressor. As you know what I mean? It's kind of the same concept of, you know, you got a luxury car, you wouldn't put some shitty engine, you know, Hyundai Sonata engine or some crap, and you know, a Lambo, right? You got this beautiful car, you need to power it with something proper. So as you go up in airbrush quality, you probably want to bring your compressor up. This is a continuous run compressor, and the other option is to have something like a, you know, mechanic compressor where the motor will compress a tank, and that tank will have some PSI reserve in it, and that will give you a more fluid, continuous flow of air. Those are the top line better stuff. Those are going to be more expensive. You do not need that. I'm just saying, as you progress, that's where you would go.
Yep, absolutely. And you can see, like, you know, I don't know if they actually have any here, maybe not, but whatever. Yes, it's easy to recognize the difference because it would be like this on top of a big tank, right? Yep. Is what it will look like. It'll look like this thing with another big tank underneath it. And yeah, that'll. When you're really getting into like the high level fine work, you want something like that where it's going to have that very regular airflow. The bright side is you honestly don't need a lot of PSI. Like, you're running it at probably 18, 20, you know, something like that. What is it, 1.8 millibars or however it said. So you don't run it real high. You do not want to, you're not trying to blow the doors off anything with your air pressure. It's again, pretty low.
This is always by feel too. This is estimations, you know, 18 to 25, a little bit by feel. People run it higher, lower, depending on their preference, you know, based on the dual action, what they want or the paints they're using, right? All that's play with to figure out.
Yep. All right. So I'll put a link for that down below. I think that's a nice little
I will jump in and say I'm a big fan of Iwata. They make very good products. Neo by Iwata is their version of a starter brush, I'm pretty sure. It's well under $100. I think I got it off eBay for like $50 or $60. It's full metal. It's a quality airbrush for what you're going to do. Most people won't notice the difference between that and the high-quality airbrush, especially not a starter. So if I was going to recommend a brand airbrush to start with, Neo by Iwata. Iwata is a great company. If you want to upgrade and go to their higher-tier stuff, absolutely going to be fine. They do great stuff. Badger as well. Badger's higher-level airbrushes are very, very good. So that's also another route to go.
Very good. I like it. All right. Well, that was a lot about airbrushes. I don't know. Is there anything else you can think of you want to cover?
Real quick, if you do get an airbrush, I think that Vince will probably attest to this. I got two things that are quick, very helpful things, especially if you're an experienced airbrusher or getting into experienced things. So this is Tamiya masking tape.
Yes. We were going to talk about masking. Thank you. I appreciate
it. So masking real quick. We're not going to spend too long on this because we've been kind of dragging this out a little bit. There's so much to talk about with airbrushing, but these are off Amazon. How much were these events? Like $5?
Yeah, it's something like that. It's super cheap, $4 or $5.
This is just masking tape, but I have not had any paint peel off from this. I have had paint peel off from regular masking tape or different brands of masking tape. So do yourself a favor. Don't ruin your work. Invest in this. This is great for making lines, you know, masking off different parts you don't want to spray. If you want to do littler parts with airbrushing, this is how you get there, is covering one area so that you can spray some area that's smaller than what you can really do feasibly. So you cover that area, do something else, and it's really great for, you know, your swords with your non-metallic metal, where you do one side of the sword and take off the mask, do the other side of the sword and cover the other side that you just did. Really great. To me, a masking tape works wonders. Comes in two different sizes. I'd get both. It's dirt cheap. The next thing that I have found that works amazing, these little eggs, you might recognize them from being a child. This is Silly Putty. What this does is does not leave greasy residue like any other masking thing, and it's dirt cheap as well. You want the brand name. I've heard bad things about off-brand. So get the little Easter egg of actual Silly Putty, and you can just kind of press this over where you want. And this is great instead of the masking tape, which is straight lines, right? You can do, you know, cover whatever form or feature you want on the model. It also would be great for doing, you know, camo patterns and other things that are sort of organic, shapey type deals. So those are the two masking options that I would certainly get and have no qualms with recommending.
Anything else? The third option is just the liquid mask, which is actually like a paint-on thing that then you wipe off later. It's a little trickier to use if you really need to be like spot careful with it, where you're doing the whole model with an airbrush, like even down to granular detail. You need to get into liquid mask so you can like get very specific lines and things where you're basically painting on your mask. I would say if you get to that level, just watch the requisite videos on it and they'll show you how to use liquid mask. There's a lot out there of talking about how to apply liquid mask.
You're probably above both our expertise at that point.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of it. I go for the tape and the Silly Putty like you, since you said that, I'm all about it. I love it. I love the Silly Putty is absolute fantastic. So
good stuff. Last hot tip of the week. You decide to get your airbrush. You're all in. First thing you do, paint a model, right? Wrong. You take your airbrush and you play tic-tac-toe with yourself at least 10 times. What this does is gives you brush control, and you need it. You're going to piss yourself off so much if you just go onto a model and you just have no idea where you're spraying paint, and it just comes out all over the place, and it comes out too much, too little. When you're talking about the dual action where you have to pull back and get, you know, this action determines how much paint's coming out, that's a fine motor action, right? You need to practice that a little bit. even play tic-tac-toe with tiny lines, try and make straight tiny lines. Just take a piece of paper and doodle on it. That's all. And it's fun. You know what I mean? You're just playing with an airbrush. But make sure you do that and do that before you start trying to do fine detail work on the model.
I love it. I can't think of a better tip to end on. Play tic-tac-toe with yourself. Basically, what we're recommending is that, like the computer from War Games, learn that the only way to win is not to play. All right. So, very good. Yeah, that's a great final tip. If you got any other questions about sort of airbrushing or our experiences or anything like that, you know, don't hesitate to put some comments below. We will certainly watch them and answer them, as always, of course. And but that's shotgunning a lot of information at everyone. There's still a lot more we could probably go on for an hour just with various airbrush stuff when it gets down to all sorts of techniques and different things you can do. I will, like I said, put links for a bunch of things down below. And we'll go from there. All right. So, are there
any questions posted up before we move on, or?
No, not at the moment. There was a couple people that just said, you know, what's up, and said hi. Anthony said he was ready for excellence. So, you know, I hope we've delivered. Jesse Tarswell says, what's up? You know, just that kind of thing. So people checking in. Hello to all of you. We're glad to have you along on the excellent hobby adventure. So are we ready to rumble? Are we ready to determine?
There's no more speed painting on that list. I'm ready for whatever you roll now.
Now, you realize that next week I leave to on the Warhammer World Tour, the Warhammer YouTuber World Tour Challenge, and I'll be gone until after our next show. So our next show is going to have to be for me on the road somewhere. So I'm going to have like 4 days to complete this challenge, whatever it is, before I leave. So
that's very exciting. 3.5 more days than you need, Vince.
All right. Here we go. So would you like to review the list of what is number one through number 10 and what are our chances today?
Make sure I still have it open here. Topics. We got it. All right. From 1 to 10, we have a basing challenge. My concept for this was we're basically going to go for more of a display quality base or a high-level base. You can put a model on it if you want to. If not, whatever. We're going to do best base we can make. Number 2, freehand, specifically on capes. Any sort of cape, robe, whatever you want, freehand on it. Doesn't matter what it is, do it to it. Number 3, unit filler. That's new this week. Hopefully this is still a thing in 9th. I love unit fillers. I think it adds character to the bigger blocks. If we go full rounds, who knows, might not need them anymore, but I still think it's a fun topic. Adds you some converting stuff and lets you use some fun techniques.
Oh, I'll shove a unit filler in a round, you know, Lord of the Rings base. I don't care.
Yeah. Painting yellow, so tough color to do. We have another one that's color-based in this one, but next, gems, painting gems specifically. That's a tough thing to do. Very, very nice techniques in there to do that. Number 6, painting pure white. So 4 and 6, yellow and white. Both tough colors. Number 7, object source lighting. Number 8, true metallic metal. So we did non-metallic. We'll go back to the actual metallic flakes. Number 9, fire and ice. So you're going to do a warm or a cold piece. I think that me and Vince are going to flip a coin to decide which one does what. Or you do warm and cold on the same piece, which would be interesting and tough to do. And number 10, finally, that big mother. So it has to be a chariot base or bigger. Big model. How you do it, what you do to survive the grind of a big model.
I don't know what you mean. Yes, I'm excited for that one. I'm hoping for a 10 myself. Never mind the fact I've only got 4 days. Who cares? All right. So, are we ready to rumble? We have the trusty, universal, everybody's favorite, the orange D10 of fate, the die of Zeench, ready to be cast. Now, is there any number you really don't want? Tell the die. Speak to the die. What don't you want?
What don't I actually just don't care anymore.
Hey, there you go. That's all right.
This week, I'm not really in the mood to do a basing challenge, but I could do it if we had to.
All right. Well, the die knows that which is in your heart of hearts and is ready. All right, here we go. Okay. And the number of the rolling is 9. Here we go. Let me flip it down here.
Number 9.
Let me turn it like that.
Fire and ice.
Number 9.
All right. Fire and ice, my friend.
Yes, the warm and cold piece. Nope, now it's too high. This is going
to
bother.
All right, so how do you want to proceed with this?
I say...
Don't say you do a fucking warm piece and a cold piece. I'll kick you in the face.
I was going to make it way more complicated than that. I was going to say we split off and each do one, like, one of us gets warm and one of us gets cold, and we both have to do a warm and cold, so it's going to be two things. I was going to make it even worse than what you were ready to yell at me for.
No, Vince, no.
Single model that is both warm and cold.
You want to do single model that is both warm and cold?
Yes. With the option to then do additional models that are only warm or cold.
Okay.
There you go. That's my call. What do you think about that?
I like it.
All right.
I like it. I'm thinking in my mind how to play it. So this could have several meanings, I think, right? You know, you could have the temperature warm and cold. I think that's fair. What I was thinking of mentally was warm and cold colors. So you can have, you know, your warm spring piece and your dark and deep blue piece of cool or icy colors and more like that. Anything of that nature works for me.
Yeah. I'll have to really think about this one. I don't know what I have ready to go or close to that is going to meet that requirement. So that'll be interesting.
So it comes out now, Vince, huh? You got a stack of models back there. You've been pulling out. You ain't been painting any of these things. Goddamn liar.
No, ready to go, meaning like, you know.
yeah, whatever.
You saw the date and timestamp on the fig.
So you're a hacker and a liar.
Oh, very good. All right. Well, this should be a fun challenge. So tune in next time where I may or may not be in my normal chair, depending on when we do this. I may be in a random place somewhere else in the country. And we will and see the results of warm and cold. Yeah, that should be fun. There's a lot of good options there. A lot of good options. I don't know. We'll have to see. Much to think about. Paul, any closing thoughts to the viewers before we get out and get ready for the next one?
I don't think so. If you think about an airbrush, grab an airbrush. It's fun.
Absolutely. I like it. And don't be afraid to spend some money to have some fun with your hobby. And you spend a lot of money having fun with your figs. Have fun when you're making the figs, too. You probably won't regret it.
None of this is guaranteed.
Right, no guarantees. I know, I agree with you, Paul, exactly what you said. Like, I love the hell out of it. When you sit down, you feel good, right? Like, there's something that's cool and fun about it. Like, it's almost magical the way it makes paint so appear.
Well, yeah, it's like, connection. That's now a different color. I don't know how I did that.
Right. With the brush, there's a direct connection. There's paint here. I touch it to the model. Something happens. With the airbrush, you're never touching anything. It's just magic. I don't know, it's so weird.
Physics broke it.
Yeah, science. All right. Well, very good. Thank you, everybody, for watching. Leave any questions you have. Like I said, there's going to be 8 million links at the bottom of this video, so I will put everything down there that you need. And as always, thank you for joining us. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time.